My name is Jatin Nathwani. I'm the executive director of the Waterloo Institute for Sustainable Energy. For those who don't know, yes, we do exist on campus. We are a multidisciplinary research institute, and we draw our membership from all the faculties at the University of Waterloo, and been around now 9-10 years. And it is a pleasure to welcome you on this rather cold day. And we have a wonderful speaker here. We do these public talks on a relatively regular basis, so please go to our website and we try to advertise them. The idea is really begin to reach out. Energy is a complex subject, we all know, multidimensional, multifaceted. And the desire is to bring in both our professors and members of the energy community to Waterloo to share with us their ideas on some aspect of what drives the energy system, where we're going with respect to energy transitions, and so on. And today, we are particularly fortunate to have an excellent speaker, and he's, of course, one of our own here at Waterloo, Professor Keshav, Srinivasan Keshav. He received his PhD in computer science from the University of California at Berkeley in 1991. And he was subsequently a researcher at the AT&T Bell Labs and an associate professor at Cornell University. In 1999, he left the academy to co-found a company called Ensim Corporation and Green Border Technologies, Inc. He was an associate professor at the University of Waterloo from 2003 to 2008, and has been a professor since, holding the Canada Research Chair in the time frame 2004 to 2014, and also the Cisco Chair in Smart Grid from 2012 to 2017. He is the co-director of the Information Systems and Science for Energy Laboratory here at the University of Waterloo, author of two graduate textbooks on computer networking, an Alfred P. Sloan Fellow, an ACM Fellow, and currently chair of the ACM SIGCOM. Recently, he has taken the role of an associate dean of graduate studies in the Faculty of Mathematics. And his research goal for the past several years has been to apply his expertise in computer networking to find innovative solutions to large-scale problems in energy systems. His focus is on using three revolutionary technologies: solar PV generators, energy storage, and pervasive sensing to improve the efficiency and reduce the carbon footprint of the energy systems. I call this the marriage between ICT and energy systems, and I really look forward to your comments, Keshav. Please.
Thank you. Thank you all for coming. I hope you can hear me in the back. Yes? Okay, great. So what I'm going to talk to you about is a pretty high-level talk. There's almost no math, which is upsetting to me, but still, there's almost no math. And it's trying to justify the statement of, you know, what is this $1 trillion doing over here, and what's really going on? So let me start by talking about energy, global energy consumption. This is from 2013. And what you'll see right away is that it's not very green. Oil is about 33%. Coal is about 24%, gas is 24%, coal is about 30%, and if you add it all up, you get fossil fuels about 87%. And it doesn't look pretty at all. This is typical of a coal plant, and gas isn't that much better. We can do better, though. We have a choice. We have a nuclear reactor up in the sky, 93 million kilometers away, which emits a lot of radiation but doesn't affect us. So it's much better than having nuclear plants on the ground. And it's the sun. And back in 1954, three scientists at Bell Labs, Chapin, Fuller, and Pearson, discovered that if you take this little thing down there, this little capsule-like thing over there that's circled, and you put it in the sun, it creates energy. In fact, it creates free energy. Okay, it's kind of a pretty amazing thing. You know, it's almost miraculous that you can take a piece of what it looks like a piece of plastic, put it in the sun, and you get energy out of it for free. And guess what? You don't have to pay any taxes on it. The Canadian government has not figured out how to tax solar energy. You can just put it in the sun, make your own energy, and it doesn't cost you anything other than the initial cost. So people have figured out how to go from the initial idea of Chapin and Fuller to actually creating a PV system. So what you do is this. You take that little solar cell like they had in the tube, and you put it onto a sheet of paper, a sheet of plastic, and you call what's called a solar module. And these modules together form a panel, and the panels then go onto big aluminum or metal backings, and that forms a photovoltaic system. And then you need a few other things in order to make it all work. You need some kind of tracking systems, mounting, cabling, generation, et cetera, et cetera. But at the end of it, you essentially get energy for free. Okay, and so people have been doing it. They build these solar farms. This is what a typical solar farm looks like. And you can see it's fairly large, but it isn't that large. This is even larger. And this is on the boundary between Italy and Austria. And you can see the entire hillside is covered with solar panels. And it gets even bigger. This is somewhere in California, I believe. And this one is so big, it can be seen from space. It's 25 square kilometers, about 9 million panels, okay? This is the scale at which we are converting the surface of the Earth into solar panels, okay? And it's because of free energy. You can guess what this one is. Any guesses?
Disney.
It's Orlando, right? So even Disney, which is not particularly known for being green, actually is doing this. In fact, I did a little bit of analysis some time ago. We know how fast cell phones grew, and so solar is growing as fast as cell phones. So for those students in the audience, I want to show you two graphs to teach you something about how to do marketing. So on the left-hand side, you can see two curves. The orange curve on the bottom is how fast cell phones grew, and this one is how far solar grew. With the arbitrarily chosen base here. And of course, solar is growing much faster than cell phones, right? It's obvious. You can see it's growing much faster from cell phones. Well, actually, that's not true. If you do it on a logarithmic scale, you'll see that they actually have almost identical slopes, okay? It's not clear to me why they have the same slope, but the fact is they're going as fast as cell phones. So the same explosion that you can, in your own lifetime, remember from 2001 to 2015, when 2001, hardly anybody had cell phones. In 2015, hardly anybody did not have a cell phone. That same transition is going to happen now, shifted about 10 years or so. In 2010, almost nobody had solar panels. By 2025, the opposite is going to be true. Okay, and I'll try and justify that, and that's going to actually take the next 15, 20 minutes of my talk, why that's actually true. But what happens is we can actually quantify this using something called Swanson's law, and let me walk you through this because this graph is actually super important for the rest of your life, okay? What's on the x-axis is the cumulative module shipments in terms of megawatts of solar. So you have over here a tenth of a megawatt, and it's logarithmic. So you have 1,000 megawatts, 10,000 megawatts, 10 gigawatts, 100,000 gigawatts, and so on, right? And on the y-axis is the cost dollars per watt, okay? And over here, we have basically $100 a watt all the way down to 10 cents a watt, okay? Again, logarithmic scale. And what Swanson's law says is that, roughly speaking, it's a straight line, okay, from here to here. So how to interpret this is essentially in 1976, 1 watt, we shipped less than a megawatt, and it cost about $100 a watt. And in 2014, we shipped about 200,000 megawatts, and it went down to about 70 cents a watt, okay? So another way of putting it is the more you sell, the more you ship, the cheaper it gets. And the cheaper it gets, the more you ship. And around and around and around it goes. And so if you look at Swanson's law again, what you see is this. This is really a positive feedback loop where the prices are driven by volume, which is the x-axis. And so volume decreases price, and decrease in price grows more volume, and it goes round and round. And that's why we get these enormous growths that we see in solar panels. That's why hillsides get covered with solar panels, because we're in this kind of positive feedback loop. It's a bit more impressive. You see it on a linear scale. Again, I'm showing from here 1977 up to 2015, where the price has gone from $76 a watt down to actually 30 cents a watt. Okay, that's pretty impressive. Okay, and so this is, if you have nothing else to take away, it's just that the impression that people have that solar is expensive, which was the impression you may have from about 2005, 2010, it was about $4 or $5 a watt, that impression is going away. And it's going away really fast. You're going down to really, really cheap prices. So that's the first takeaway from here. But I want to spend a little bit of time talking about three characteristics of solar, which are kind of interesting. The first one of them has to do that sunlight is free, as I mentioned. There's no tax on it as of now. And so there's only a capital expense. Once you buy the panel, you put it out in the sun, you're getting energy, quote unquote, for free. There's no operation expense other than getting a squeegee and cleaning the panel off from time to time. Okay, that's all you have to do is to keep it going. The second characteristic is that it's a 20 to 25-year lifetime, which is almost maintenance-free. And the third characteristic is that different parts of the world get different amount of sunshine. If you look at northern Germany over here, it gets a lot less sun than actually Canada does. And that gets a lot less sun than Southwest US, which gets lots of sun than Saudi Arabia. So Saudi Arabia actually is not just a powerhouse for oil, it's also a powerhouse for solar. They happen to be lucky in both respects. So this leads to a concept of which I want to bring to your attention called levelized cost of energy. It's a term that I'm going to explain to you in some detail. And what it means is the effective cost of energy per kilowatt hour. A kilowatt hour is a unit of energy. Okay, it doesn't matter exactly what it is. What we're talking about is the effective cost per kilowatt hour. And so let's understand how this works, taking into account these three characteristics of solar energy. Okay, the fact that it's geographically different, there's no operational expense, and it's basically free. Okay, so let's start by looking at the x-axis. And on this axis, I'm going to draw a line, and this is about this $1,000. What is this $1,000? That's how much money I spent to buy some energy. I bought for 1,000 watts, I spent $1,000, so I spent a dollar a watt. Okay, so I'm going to put that down there. And then on the y-axis, I want to compute something. I want to compute what does it cost me per kilowatt hour? It's very simple. I want to know what it costs me per unit energy if I put down $1,000. And the answer, it kind of depends how much energy you generate. So if you look at this next graph, what you see is, I'm going to, this simple example, let's say over the lifetime of 20 years, you generate 1,000 kilowatt hours. That's the total amount of energy you produce. You put in $1,000, you generate 1,000 kilowatt hours, so each unit costs you a dollar. Straightforward. Okay, I put in $1,000, I got 1,000 kilowatt hours. At the end of it, the panel is useless, I had to throw it away. So I spent a dollar a kilowatt hour. That's my cost of energy. It's called the levelized cost of energy. All right. Now, let's make it a little bit more interesting. Let's say because of Swanson's law, it got cheaper. I didn't have to spend $1,000 anymore. I had to spend only $800 because, you know, it's 2 years in the future or something. So I move to the left over here, and I'm going to slide down this line because I spent a little bit less, but I'm still generating 1,000 kilowatt hours. So my price per kilowatt hour goes from $1 to 80 cents. It's just a linear reduction, right? And the cheaper I get, I'm going to slide down this line lower and lower on a dollar per kilowatt hour basis, right? Everybody got that? Okay. Now I'm going to make it a little bit more complicated, just a little bit more. Let's look at the impact of geography, right? Let's say that in this location is northern Germany, I get 1,000 kilowatt hours over the lifetime. And let's say in southwest US, there's double amount of sunshine. There's fewer clouds, the sun is more intense, whatever. I get 2,000. For the same $1,000, since I'm getting 2,000 amount kilowatt hours, I'm down to only 50 cents a kilowatt hour, right? So the cost of producing energy from solar depends on where you are geographically, right? And basically, once you know the upfront cost, and once you know the geographical location, after that, you can just read off the cost per kilowatt hour just off the y-axis. It's just what it is, right? So the more energy you get from the sun, depending on the geographical location, the cheaper it is. And the less energy money you spend upfront, the cheaper it is. Okay, so everybody with me here? Okay, because this graph took me forever to design, because if you just look at it up front, it doesn't make any sense at all. You really have to kind of go at bit by bit. But once you do this, you then get the conclusion, which is really beautiful, which is that conventional energy actually, if it's, let's say it's a 10 cents a kilowatt hour, that's the cost of conventional, that's roughly what it is in Canada, okay, ballpark. What happens is Swanson's law says that we're always going to slide to the left. no matter where you are. So this stays still. If you have something that's still and something that's going to go under it, no matter where you are, you're going to go under it. It's just as simple as that. You never, if you keep something that's still and something else that's going down, it's going to get cheaper. So Swanson's law basically says solar is cheaper. And actually what's happening is conventional energy costs is going up. All of you have seen that your electricity price in Ontario has gone from about 12 cents a kilowatt hour peak to about 19 cents a kilowatt hour at the peak time right now. This is why wind will not win. She will lose, OK? But maybe, who knows? I'm predicting that too. But this is going up, and this is going down. So the conclusion at this point should be pretty blindingly obvious. Solar wins everywhere. Because everywhere in the world, it's sliding to the left because of Swanson's law. And everywhere in the world, conventional energy cannot compete because you have to pay for coal or gas or nuclear materials or disposal of nuclear materials, which is even worse. All of those cost something. Solar is the only one that doesn't cost you anything other than the initial cost, and those costs are going down, right? It's just pretty much obvious. And so the solar revolution will not be led by it will be led by the accountants. They're going to do it not because it's green. They're going to do it because it's cheap. And that's the right way to do it. The biggest user of solar in Canada was, until recently, Walmart. Why? Walmart is not green. They're cheap. They're doing it because it costs less money. And that actually is, to me, the most important thing about the solar revolution is that it's going to happen because people care about money, not because they want to be green. Okay? And this is why 10 years from now, when you buy your next house, you're going to say, why isn't there a solar panel here? I don't want to pay all this money to the grid. Right? Just like you cannot imagine that, OK, I'll come to some more things. But this is going to happen, right? So this is, to me, a very, very important takeaway. So there are some problems with sunshine. For example, we get nothing at night, OK? So we kind of, it's a problem. What do you do with a solar panel on the roof and it's night? Well, you can do something, which is to use the grid, solar by day and grid by night, OK? You still come out ahead. Because remember, solar is cheaper than grid. For the, even if you displace 1 minute of grid with solar, you're still coming out ahead. All right, and so every small business owner is going to say, hey, wait a minute, if I put $10,000 and I buy the solar panel, put it on my roof, I'm going to come out ahead, let me do it. Now, homeowners may not do it because every 7 years they move, and right now in Canada, your typical time to live in a house is about 7 years, and the typical time for you to get your money back is about 7 to 9 years. Okay, but in 5 years from now, the time to get your money back is going to come down from 7 to 9 years to about 2 to 3 years. And then everybody's going to start doing it because they're going to get the money back before they sell the house. So this problem is going to go away. Now, I'm not answering the question, how do you get, what does grid do at night? Let's talk about that later, but I'm not going to answer that. But yes, something has to be done. Nevertheless, this does reduce our dependency on coal and gas, and for that matter, nuclear. So it's all in all, a good thing to do. A second problem with the solar is actually excess solar. There's some countries where they have so much solar, like in Germany, that they have a problem. The price of electricity goes negative. So this is on May 8th, 2016. And I got it from this Agora Energiewende. And what I'm showing in red over here is €0, okay, per megawatt. And what happened was green is basically solar and wind. This is blue is conventional, and you can see the power price. It was at €25, and then got so much wind, and the red over here is the electricity consumption. There was less consumption than generation, and so they had to get rid of the energy. And the way they got rid of the energy is say, okay, we'll pay you to take energy. And you say, okay, okay, that only happens in Germany. It doesn't happen anywhere else. Well, guess what? That's not true. It happens in Chile. About once a day, every day, Chile has too much energy. It also happens in Ontario. We have must-buy wind, and wind comes on at night when we can't reduce our nuclear. So every night, we pay Quebec to take our energy away from us, and the next day, we buy it back from them. Okay, and this is why they have free childcare and we don't. Okay, that's not actually true. But I mean, the fact of the matter is, negative energy prices will happen because the fact solar is so cheap. Just put it out there, and if it's made must-buy, which some jurisdictions do, then we have this kind of problem. But there's something you can do about it, and this is actually, to me, one of the coolest ideas ever, which is, it's called solar desalination. So you put one of these devices over here, it's just a standard reverse osmosis desalination device, and you put this next to the ocean, and whenever you have excess solar, make water, right? Just make water and sell it. You know, here people will pay ridiculous amounts of money for what amounts to tap water, okay? I mean, they pay $3 per million liters and sell it to you for $1 for 100 milliliters. What a scam. At any rate, you can participate in the same scam by putting freeze energy over here and put it in the water and call it solar green water, which will actually be true. And you don't have excess energy, and you don't have negative prices. And you can do the same thing with wind as well. And of course, you can also hydrolyze water and make hydrogen gas. But luckily for us, water is not explosive, and hydrogen gas is. So you're better off making water and selling it in plastic bottles or something more environmentally friendly with the excess solar. Okay. So I think that actually is a nice problem to have. There's a more insidious problem, and that's the variability. And I'm going to spend a little bit more time on this because it's pretty fascinating. So this is a beautiful graph that's from Barnhart et al. In this journal. And what I'm showing over here is one day. Actually, I'm showing 30 days. And each of these blue lines is the wind production between midnight and midnight for one full day. And you can see, and it's all been normalized to one. So, okay, zero to one. And you can see the blue lines go up and down. So wind, you know, the wind blows. Nobody knows how the wind blows. And you can see it. This actually illustrates that saying. Solar, well, it's not. There's no sun at night. And then you get a certain amount of solar radiation. But even within the day, there's a lot of variability because of clouds. Okay, there's a huge, if a cloud goes across the face of the sun, you can have a 95% drop in solar in about 5, 10 seconds. It's very, very fast drops. So you have that problem. And that's the red is your demand. The demand is relatively predictable. Okay, it varies, of course, but 30 days of demand looks pretty much the same. 30 days of wind is completely crazy, and 30 days of solar, okay, it changes a lot. Okay, so how do you deal with this variability? And so the answer right now is storage. Okay, the biggest form of storage, and in fact, the most widely used form of storage today, it's called double reservoir system, like I'm showing over here. So there's a reservoir over here, and there's a reservoir over here. And what you do is, whenever there's extra solar or you have extra energy, you pump it up. And when you need it, you put it down again, and you have a little hydro plant to generate electricity. And that's basically what you do. So almost all the storage in the world today looks like this. Okay? There's only one problem with this. You need mountains. Okay? And there are none in Ontario. We can't build this in Ontario. The closest we can get is to take big plastic bags and sink them into Lake Ontario and fill them with compressed air and make them go up and down. And that's the hydro store project being done off Center Island in Toronto right now. But we don't have hills. And so Germany and Austria have the same relationship that we have with Quebec. Whenever they generate excess electricity, Austria makes money. We're pumping it up, and then they sell it back again. We're pumping it down again. So that's most of storage today. But storage is hot. Okay, some people expect that more than $122 billion will be spent on storage in the next few years. And this graph, again, is worth looking at more carefully. This is from Nature Energy. And what it's showing, again, I'm going to go through it very carefully. On the x-axis is time from 2005 until 2030. On the y-axis is the cost of storage per kilowatt hour. Remember, kilowatt hour is energy, unit of energy. It's cost per energy storage unit. And each of these pluses and stars, all this, is basically a data point from some manufacturer. So some manufacturer over here, it cost them $1,800 per kilowatt hour in 2010, and it kind of goes down. This band over here is the average. This is the interesting part over here. Each of these is a forecast by an expert. And the expert will ask, what's going to be the future of storage? And the cheapest energy storage, which an expert thought would be in 2020, was about $200 a kilowatt hour. They said the most optimistic expert said, in 2020, we're going to get $200 a kilowatt hour. Guess what? This $200 was achieved in 2016 already, 4 years ahead of target. So all the experts are wrong, okay? Or rather, I should say, the experts are pessimistic. matters have overtaken them. And in fact, if you look at the graph here, this is the same Swanson's curve graph again. On the x-axis is cumulative production, and the y-axis is the price. It's logarithmic on both scales. This is the solar curve I showed you earlier, okay? And this is the curve for storage. And of course, solar goes back to 76, storage only starts in 2010, but it's going down in that same kind of experience curve, or Swanson's law, the law which says the more you ship, the cheaper it gets, and the more we ship, right? And that positive feedback cycle is now taking into place, because now what's happened is this very interesting thing. The same technology of storage is being used for cars and laptops and cell phones and for grid energy. It's all lithium ion. So anybody who does anything in lithium ion or polymer technology, or sorry, material science or chemistry is doing lithium ion, right? If you go to campus, you look at chemistry, all of them, if they have any sense of this, are working on lithium ion, because that's where all the money is, right? And it's not small amounts of money, it's huge gobs of money. Why? Another reason for this is because of this picture here. This is what a Nissan Leaf looks like when you cut it open, okay? And each of these lunch boxes over here, that's a lithium ion battery. If you think about it, what you see is quite clearly that a Nissan Leaf is basically just a big box full of storage which has wheels attached to it. It's just mobile storage, okay? And a driver, and in some years from now, they won't even be a driver. They'll be a passenger, right? It's a big box of storage with a computer driving it. And that's what cars are gonna look like, and I'll show you a few minutes what it is. And this is why Tesla is building the Gigafactory, where they have brought the cost of production from $600 a watt to $200 a watt by using the Gigafactory. Actually, Gigafactory has already opened production a few months ago. And with this kind of numbers, basically, electric vehicles become very, very affordable. Okay. So I started out by saying storage is important because you want to balance supply and demand. But storage is also important because it forms the basis of transportation. And so the other pillar of the new economy is not just solar, but storage. And storage in the form of grid storage, but storage in the form of electric vehicles. Okay. If you look at this graph here, you'll see exactly what I mean. So it's a bit hard to understand, bear with me. On the x-axis is the battery cost. What is the dollar cost per kilowatt hour? Remember what I was talking about, $200 a kilowatt hour. That's one over there, it's circled over there. And this is the cost of energy from gasoline in dollars per gallon. Okay, this is an American thing, so it's dollars per gallon. What this essentially says is, as you go towards the left, as you go cheaper and cheaper, no matter what the US price per gallon is, you're going to be better off doing electric vehicles. Electric vehicles are competitive, okay? As battery costs get more and more expensive, or the price of gas is low, internal combustion vehicles are competitive. Okay, but we are moving all the way, Swanson's law, we're pushing towards the left, so essentially we are over here. Gigafactory estimates are in this range, and so electric vehicles are competitive. So if you do a cost-benefit analysis over a lifetime of a car today, you'll find you're actually better off buying an electric car as long as two things hold. First, the battery doesn't die on you, okay, and we don't know that for sure. And second, the price of gas remains at about $1 a liter and doesn't go too far below. Okay, as long as that's true, you'll find that you're going to be in this part of the graph, and it always is competitive to buy electric cars. And in fact, because of this, electric sales are going through the roof. So this is the sales between 2010 and 2016. And first of all, notice that in 2010, the number of sales was essentially zero. That's not that long ago. 2010 was just 7 years ago. 7 years ago, if you went and bought an electric car, you were a nerd or a hero or an idiot, you know, because you're spending tons of money on buying, you know, cool technology which is going to die on you, right? But that was 7 years ago. Look at what's happened. 2016, 800,000 electric cars sold, and look where the chunk is coming from. That's not the U.S. That's China. If you look at it, Chinese government has put into place enough incentives. For example, free registration, so that this has become huge. So China is the biggest market for electric cars, and Tesla is not the biggest manufacturer of electric vehicles. They get all the press, but BYD, stands for Build Your Dreams, is the biggest manufacturer of electric cars in the world. And they're selling it all in China, and they're going to come soon to a dealer near you. Okay. Bloomberg, which is hardly a green it's not, Bloomberg is not Greenpeace, okay? Let's be clear here. Okay, they think that 35% of new sales in 2040 will be electric cars, you know, battery cars and PHEVs. Why? The more you ship, the cheaper it gets, and round we go. This is another thing that's on this positive feedback cycle, because today you can actually imagine going and buying a car. Look at the car in Canada, EVs in Canada. This is 2014, only 5,000 were sold across all of Canada, 5,300. It's doubled in 2016, and in fact, the biggest selling model is Chevy Volt. Okay, the Chevy Bolt came out day before yesterday in the newspaper. You might have seen it. The first Chevy Bolt, all-electric car, was sold to somebody in Toronto. The range is about 400 kilometers on battery, 400 kilometers. Okay. So this is happening here, too. Now, we are very, very far away from the Chinese. The Chinese have bought close to about 400,000 vehicles, but Canada is getting there. Can anybody guess how many different models of electric cars are available in Canada today, right now? Can you guess? Yeah?
I think it's around 37.
Yeah. 37 different models are available, including Audis and BMWs and Mitsubishi and Nissan and this and that. If somebody told you 5 years ago that there'll be 37 models of electric vehicles available on February 1st, 2017, they told that to you on February 1st, 2012, what would you say? What were you smoking? Okay. And you must have inhaled, right? Things are changing. Things are really changing, right? Okay, some other news for you. Buildings use a lot of energy. And the funny thing is, lighting takes a lot of energy. In my office, I have 6 compact fluorescent lights, and they take more energy than anything else in my office. Okay, more than all my computers and this and that, printers. All of my computers, you know, they just take 10, 20, 30 watts. Each bulb takes about 30 to 40 watts. Okay, and in this room, we have, I don't know how many bulbs over here, probably about 50 tube lights, I'm guessing. Each of them is about 30 watts. It's 1.5 kilowatts just for the lighting. Okay, so it's a lot. It costs about $230 billion a year. But here's what's happening in another part of the world, which is when you go from incandescent to compact fluorescent to LED, you go from 10 to 2 to 1. LEDs are like the microprocessors of lighting. Okay, they use the same kind of silicon technology. Just like solar cells are the microprocessors of energy, right? They're using silicon technology instead of coal or natural gas. In the same way, LEDs are using the same technology. So they're on this very same cost curve. On the y-axis over here is the cost in dollars per lumen, I think. I accidentally cut this off. And this is the time. It doesn't matter. Look at the green curve. That's the cost curve for LEDs. If any of you went to Home Depot in last fall, you would have gotten 3 LED bulbs for $2, okay? 3 LED light bulbs for $2. Again, if 5 years ago, when they cost $30 each, somebody told you, in 5 years from now, you can get 3 LED bulbs for $2 rather than paying $90, they'd say, what are you smoking? But in fact, I bought 9 of them. I didn't buy 3. I bought 9 of them. They're just sitting there. Because we're in the same cost curve over here. Look at this graph over here. I focus on this green one over here. In 2011, and on the y-axis, look at the y-axis, LEDs is a percent of total shipments. It was between 2 or 3% of total shipments. In 2017, expected to be almost more than 25%. Okay? More than 25%. Again, the more you ship, the cheaper it gets. Same exact positive feedback cycle is happening for LEDs as well, right? And so to sum up, solar, storage, LED are all declining at these exponential curves, rates, okay? It doesn't matter exactly what the exponential value is. The fact is they're all going down very, very fast. Of course, they're never going to be zero, right? Not going to happen. But they'll be very cheap, okay? And so far, so good. But something is missing, okay? What is missing is essentially sensing and control. I want to explain that. I'm going to take about 5 minutes explaining what I mean by that and why it's important. In the electrical grid, it's important to have generation and load balance all the time. If you have too much generation or too much load, we have problems. We have grid instability problems. Very, very bad things can happen. in the conventional grid, we have load being sort of unknown. So this is the time now. The future, we don't know what it is exactly. It's going to evolve in its own way. But we can control generation. We have a knob. We tell this coal increase, decrease, or hydro, or thermal, or whatever. We can control all of them very well. When you get the new kind of grid, we have a problem. Both sides are what we call stochastic. Both of them are variable. And what do you do? You can't tell the sun shines stronger. Okay, you have a big problem. And this is what I meant by decoupling. You can put storage in between to match supply and demand and put a control knob over here. But in order for you to do that, you actually need to not just control storage. You need to control the generation side and the load side to the extent possible. And to do this, you need to forecast, you need to monitor, you need to control. And for that, you need to measure. You need to communicate. You need to process. You need to compute. And that for that, you need the Internet of Things, right? And so that's the missing element. We can't just put solar and expect it to just work. You have to put solar and you need control, right? You need the marriage, as Jatin was saying, of ICT and energy, because without that, it doesn't really work, right? Luckily for us, sensors are getting pretty damn small. This is the LIS. It's a sensor from ST Microelectronics. That's how small. It's 2 millimeters, 1 millimeter, like that. It's the size of a grain of sand. It happens to be an accelerometer. It doesn't really matter. Other sensors are getting this size as well. So sensing, which is to know how, what's happening in the world, is getting pervasive. We've built computer networks which span the world, communication links which span the world. So communication is getting very, very cheap. So I can put a sensor somewhere. I can put 100 sensors in this room, for example, that's measuring temperature, not in the room, but in a small volume of the air in that room and communicate back to me. And we can compute it. We can control it using small processors. That's a very, very tiny processor from Freescale. This is a very nice processor. It's from, it's an entire Linux computer. It costs $5. A company called Onion makes it in Toronto. It was done by former students from Waterloo. One of the co-founders is from Waterloo. That's the Nest. You heard about it. And of course, that's a smartphone. They have the ability to control things. And you know, even though it looks daunting, I think the technology is there to do it. And so in summary, IoT allows pervasive communication, sensing, computation, control. We have that. And that's really what we study as computer scientists. That's why computer science has a role to play in this future world. And like all the other graphs, it's also growing. This is the 50 billion. How many IoT endpoints will be there? According to Cisco, who has every incentive to lie to you, you know, they claim it's going to be 50 billion in, by 2020. A billion here, a billion there, who cares? You know, it's, the problem is, the important thing is the more you ship, the cheaper it gets. Okay. So let's look 10 years into the future. What does the world look like? You know, when we have all these sensors, the new solar panels everywhere, wind farms, storage, as Shakespeare put it, oh, brave new world. Okay? How beauteous. This is a beautiful picture. It's from the European Technology Platform Vision document. It doesn't sound so pretty, but this is what it looks like. And I'll walk you through it. This is what the world looks like in the future according to this platform. And you know, they're not that far off. So to begin with, we talk about renewable generation. So we're going to have offshore wind, solar panels, onshore wind, tidal energy, and biomass. Okay, so these are the sources of generation which are all essentially either carbon-free or carbon-neutral. Biomass is carbon-neutral. We're going to have demand-side management, which basically means telling people, look, don't use energy now because it's expensive to do so. Time-of-use pricing in Ontario is an example of demand-side management. It's a bit clunky, but that's the basic idea over here. So we're going to reduce the peak to average. It's a more of a technical term. But the idea being that you're going to tell all these endpoints, hold off. Why? Because we don't have enough supply right now, and our storage is empty, right? So we need to tell people to back off. We need to do storage management. Remember, the middle was the storage. So we're going to have storage in all sorts of different forms. You're going to put storage management in the wind so that if you have excess wind, you can store it. If you have excess solar, you can store that too. And you can store energy in the form of gas or thermal storage and so on. So there's going to be storage or battery storage pretty much everywhere. And I forgot to mention storage in the form of electric vehicles, which I have on the road. So basically, you can have electric cars over here connected to the grid, which is storing energy or storing hydrogen, could have hydrogen fuel cells as well. And to make it all happen, you need sensing, communication, and control. Okay, you need that, otherwise the whole thing just falls apart. This overall is going to be like a tsunami. Okay, we are not talking about small changes. We're talking about enormous changes in the way things are done. And that's why we get the $30 trillion number, the $30 trillion of economic activity. I'm going to put it two caveats right away. It's $30 trillion over 20 years, not right away. And it's very approximate numbers. If you think carefully about it, it's going to fall apart. So don't think carefully about it. Just trust me, it's all good. Okay. So let's start by saying, where is this $30 trillion coming from? Begin with, if the fuel cost of transportation is enormous. This is a projection from the International Energy Agency of the cost of fuel for various scenarios. It doesn't really matter. But the fuel cost of transportation is approximately $3.5 trillion a year right now. $3.5 trillion is what the world is spending today for all sorts of transportation, right? Obviously, we can't replace all transportation with clean transportation. We're not going to have solar powered planes anytime soon. The density is not there, okay? But cars you can do, some kinds of trucks. I think 30% of the vehicles, which is what Bloomberg says is going to do, can be solar powered. Okay, imagine just having a solar roof on your garage and you charge the car with it. You're done. You don't need to buy gas ever again. And this is getting to be close to be true in many parts of the world, probably not in Canada. Right? Because then in January and February, you won't drive. But if you're living in other parts of the world which are more blessed with sunshine, 30% solar power transportation, that gives you $1 trillion a year in economic displacement. That means $1 trillion of gas not sold by gas companies. That's negative economic activity. How about electricity utilities? So you can't read this very well, but this shows the revenues of the world's largest electricity utilities. And the biggest one in the world, E.ON in Germany, makes about $140 billion a year in revenue. And if you add it all up, it's about $1 trillion, roughly. Okay? My guess is that we're going to have half of the energy being generated by these utilities move to solar and wind. Okay, I'm kind of including wind here for now, but $500 trillion a year in revenue. Again, they're going to have to do $500 trillion a year worth of economic activity based on solar and wind. IoT, if you're going to do $1 trillion a year of revenue, you're going to have 10% of that being spent on systems maintenance, management, and so on. So I'm just saying, okay, $100 billion a year. Okay, what's a 0.1 trillion between friends? It's not a big deal. Okay, so that gives us IoT spending. And finally, if you remember, we are spending about $230 billion in LED. So LED lighting is going to cost result in about $0.2 trillion a year of demand side savings from LED. And if you add it all up, you get about $1.85 trillion a year in economic disruption due to these changes. These are not small changes, which adds up to actually $37 trillion, so I undercounted. It's $37 trillion a year of economic, over 20 years, right? Okay. I'm actually lying to you because, for example, for the cars, I said, you know, it's going to be 30% and multiply 30% and so on. It got to 30% only in 2040, not right away. So the curve is going up like this, and I'm taking this whole area into this curve and saying that's the economic activity. Actually, it's not true. However, these curves do have the shape, so it's sort of okay. If you go over a little bit more than 30 years, depending on the shape of this curve, it's going to be that much activity, something like that, right? It's very hard to predict the future, but some things are very clear. Let me just take a moment to say what I mean by that. If something is big, there's going to be at least billions of dollars attached to it, right? Is that happening? Can you actually see headlines? So here are some headlines I got from the last few days. Bill Gates saying, I'm investing $1 billion of my own money. Okay. All right, he's a multi-billionaire, you know, he's got a lot of money. Okay, so but I would not invest $1 billion of my money, but for other reasons. Okay. Apple is investing $3 billion in solar. Okay, that's a pretty decent number, you know. It gets better. Warren Buffett is putting $15 billion into solar and wind. Okay, that's from a few months ago. Japan is investing $20 billion in Indian solar power. Okay, it's kind of adding up. And China is aiming to spend $360 billion on renewable energy by 2020. Okay, a billion here, a billion there, it adds up. And here is the first deal I've seen which has the word trillion in it. This is a deal signed by Ségolène Royal, who's the energy minister in France, and the French environment minister and the Indian energy minister, $1 trillion investment in International Solar Alliance. $1 trillion, it's right there, just for solar, but just two countries. Okay, so is it hyperbole to say $30 trillion? Yes, but it managed to get you into the room. Okay, but I'm not too far off. I have rarely seen these kinds of headlines where you routinely say $360 billion investment in 3 years. That's a lot of money. It's a lot of money by any account. Okay, so what are we doing about it? We created a lab. Okay. Catherine Rosenberg, who's unfortunately not here, she's on sabbatical, and she's a professor in electrical engineering. She and I created the Information Systems and Science for Energy Lab. We wanted to create a name that was absolutely impossible to remember, and nobody could pronounce it properly, so that's what we gave it. And we came with a nice logo. We call it ISS4E, and this is our goal: to increase the efficiency, reduce the carbon footprint of energy systems. That's what we wrote down in 2010. We haven't changed the word since. And in a nutshell, this is what we do. We look at three different contexts: smart homes and buildings, distribution network, this is the last end of the electrical grid, and distributed generation, which is basically solar type generation, and the new technologies, solar and wind, storage, EVs, LED lighting, pervasive communication. And the kind of work we're trying to do is internet inspired, because the grid is going from becoming centrally controlled, like the Soviet Empire, into something that looks very decentralized, very much like the internet. So we're actually seeing the transition happening. We work in energy system design. We do data-driven analysis because you have lots of sensors. You get lots of data, so we analyze that. And we do optimization to reduce the carbon footprint. And you can see more and more about it at our website, iss4e.ca. And I'm going to end with just one question for the audience, which is this. So the pond fills on the 30th day. When is the pond half full? Yeah, everybody, yeah, go ahead. The day before 29th day. So until the 29th day, you're saying, oh, nothing's going on. There's nothing happening. You know, there's nothing going on at all, because it looks like nothing is going on. But on the last day, it just doubles. And that's the essential nature of an exponential, the essential nature of a positive feedback loop. And these positive feedback loops in solar, in storage, in IoT, in electric vehicles, and LED lighting are going to bring this brave new world. So I'll finally end by saying all this work would not have been possible without my students. Here they are enjoying themselves at the grad house. And I'm not going to name all of them, but there's lots. And I thank all of them for their contributions. So with that, I'll stop and take any questions.
Questions, but for recording purposes, you guys have to speak in this
one. I think in the back over there.
Oh.
Yeah, he was first.
That guy from KIT, the red structure.
Yes, Patrick Joachim, yeah. Yeah, he was visiting from KIT, yeah.
Thank you very much for a very interesting talk. My question is, what happens to the pond on the 31st day? What are the limits to this exponential growth? You know, is it space? Is it materials? Is it under what circumstances does this growth no longer work?
Yeah, I think that's a very good question. And I'll actually show you one figure which explains. Sorry about that. Okay, so essentially all exponentials are actually logistic curves. No physical system can grow exponentially forever. It's going to run out of something, right? While the cost of solar is going down exponentially fast, the cost of balance of material is not going down that fast, right? Trenching, wiring, support, making sure it doesn't get blown away in the wind, things like that. So those, when they become significant, that's going to limit the exponential. Land space is going to be another factor, right? How much land can you take over with solar? But it's not that bad. 100 square kilometers is enough to produce enough solar. It will produce enough solar energy for the whole world if it's in the Sahara Desert, right? 100 kilometers by 100 kilometers. So that's about how much we need in that radiation zone. it's hard to tell what is going to get bottlenecked. At this point, there don't seem to be barriers that are preventing us. We're still in the steep part of the curve. We're nowhere close to here, but we're sort of in this range. For example, both India and China announced $100 billion worth of investment 2 years ago for 100 gigawatts each of solar by 2020. People thought it was a joke, right? China is going to meet the target already in 2018. And India's got they went from 3 gigawatts to about 50 gigawatts now. They're at 50. And this was considered impossible that they would do it, but that's 200 gigawatts, equivalent of 200 nuclear power plants being done in 5 years, and they're ahead of target, right? So we are not, so your point is well taken. Yes, we will always get into this flat part at some point. Beyond, I don't think we're there yet, and I don't know what's going to be the reason. Over here, yeah.
Thank you so much, Professor, for your time, and it's a very motivating, inspiring talk, and it paints a very, very positive picture. My question is that I don't see you mentioning the regulatory constraints of Canada, specifically Ontario, especially in DERMS, distributed energy resource management systems. Opus One's doing a great job, but I think compared to a lot of the states, whether it's in New York, whether it's in California, Ontario's falling behind in terms of regulation. What's your answer to that in terms of what should the Canadian government do to make sure that we're at the same pace as the Chinese, as the Indians, as the Americans?
Thanks. Okay, so let me repeat the question. The question is, why is Ontario not deploying these distributed resources at the same pace as the Americans, particularly California and the Chinese? And I think it comes down to two or three very important facts. The first fact being that Ontario is already very green. If you look at our carbon footprint, which is not, if you take away nuclear, hydro, wind, and to some extent solar, we're only about 30% carbon dependent, mostly on natural gas. And so there isn't a big push towards that. Like in China, they're driven by smog, right? And coal. We don't have coal. We already paid billions of dollars to get rid of coal. So we don't have that kind of push. So we're already quite green. So that's number one. Number two, we mostly went for wind. And wind is blowing at night when we don't need the energy. So we actually are producing, can get negative prices essentially, okay? Not for domestic, but for commercial. And so we have this sort of bad renewable energy, okay, here. And so without the push from the need for clean energy and also the fact that the investments have been made in a not a very good way, in my opinion, in terms of choosing between wind and solar, and the fact that our solar radiation here is not that strong, we are going to be laggards for solar. Until the price drops so low, then it's still worth doing it. But without considerable price support from feed-in tariffs, there is no hope for solar here at this point. But I think, you know, again, 5 years from now, it's going to change. And it will change. It has changed in places like Hawaii, which is 40% solar, or Southern Australia, which is, I think, more than 50% solar. So, you know, the economics are driven by that.
Take away hope and you take away a lot of aspiration. But Ontario faces a huge amount of residual debt from our transmission and distribution infrastructure, from our nuclear power plants, the decommissioning of nuclear power plants.
Yes.
And it would be brilliant if out of this discussion one person could come up with the idea of how to use solar or renewables to eliminate that debt and ultimately take us to the point where we don't need nuclear again. Have you given any consideration to that?
Yes, I have. And I mean, you can repeat the question. Can we use solar to somehow eliminate nuclear, right? Nuclear is always tied to big government, because of the heavy capital intensive nature of nuclear. So you can't get nuclear and government away from each other. It's very difficult to get them disentangled. At this point, the provincial government has made a considerable investment, a $20 billion investment over the next, I don't know how many, for nuclear. Until the government steps away from it, it's not going to happen, right? That the nuclear is going to go away. The government has to make the change. My belief is that solar is not ready for that at the price point it is in Ontario today. We have to wait a few more years. But if you look at what's happening in Germany, they are shutting down nuclear, particularly Japan. They're shutting down nuclear a lot, and have shut down, actually. And they're replacing it with both demand reduction and solar. And so there is a path. We won't be the leaders. But we will eventually get there. That's my opinion.
I enjoyed the talk.
I actually have two 10-kilowatt solar arrays, and I got in 6 years ago. I also drive a Chevy Volt, and I've been in renewables since 2000 and an interest in it. And to me, I look at it, it's always been freedom. And I see two problems. One is the political aspect of trying to convince people of this freedom, because they don't do math very well. Yeah. They always look at, you know, 7-year payback as being a big problem.
Yeah.
But they also then, what about oil companies? Because they still have a product that they want to sell, and there's billions of dollars to be made there. What do you feel as changing the minds and getting people to understand that? I look at oil as, you know, it could be the demise of, you know, the world, mm-hmm. because of the life cycle of it, especially, yeah. say, talking plastic water bottles,
yeah.
everything, just that respect.
Yeah. Let me try and summarize the question as what happens to the oil companies, right? I think, and the role of oil. First of all, even in the distant future, we're going to need some oil. As I said, we're never going to be able to fly. We don't have the energy density today. I don't expect that we will have the energy density of gasoline or kerosene in batteries anytime soon. So maybe that's not going to happen. But I believe that 2/3 of oil will still be there, but 30% can be displaced for transportation purposes, right? That's still quite big. That's still $1 trillion a year. That's number one. Number two, solar plus EV is a really strong combination, right? It, as you said, it has freedom. It gives you the freedom to say, I don't care, I'm self-propelled, right? And as the prices of EVs drop and the price of solar drops, it's going to become more and more possible to have that kind of freedom and experience it. What Tesla has done is to change the mindset on EVs, right? When you got your EV 4 years ago or 3 years ago, when Tesla was still thought of as a toy, people may think you are crazy. Why do you buy an EV, right? But today, I think more and more people are willing to say, oh, I'll buy an EV. And that mindset changes. When that mindset changes, you get onto that exponential, because more people around you have it, and then your threshold drops, and it's another positive feedback cycle. So I think the oil companies are never going to go away, because we need them for some things. But their dominant role is going to decline. And once you have a carbon tax or whatever, you're certainly going to have to keep a considerable amount of oil in the ground, right? Not take it out. And when that happens, I think their prominence is going to go down, because they're going to be sitting on frozen assets. Okay. Yes?
Thanks for your talk. That was really good. So I'm a climate activist, and I've been working really hard to help Canada get a price on carbon. Given this cost curve, am I just wasting my time? Is it going to happen anyway? Like the transition away from fossil fuels.
Okay, so the question is the transition from fossil fuels going to happen anyway without having a price on carbon? I think that one should take a look at it with a slightly different perspective. You know, what brought the price of solar down, right? If you look at this graph, there's a very fascinating little blip in there, which I wanted, maybe I don't know if I can get to it or not, but what you'll see is something that happened in 2008 when the when you'll see that the slope suddenly changed for this. And if you remember the 2000, what happened was that was the German EEG Act, which said that they're going to put feed-in tariffs, right? So the Germans did something, I'm sorry, it's going to take forever to get me this, but the Germans did something for the world, which was they paid about 140 billion euros worth of tax to subsidize solar. It was a transfer from the whole of Germany to the solar farms in southern Germany primarily, and they all made a lot of money. And it was a tax that everybody paid so that they could kickstart this engine to get solar to be more cost effective. And so the Germans did it, and the Chinese took over, right? And so the Chinese would not have taken over if the Germans hadn't put the money in, right? In the same way, a carbon tax gives this nudge. It's something that can be removed. So at this point in Germany, there is no feed-in tariff. It's actually negative to some extent, right? But it was needed. So I think a carbon tax is needed now, right? But it can go away. And I was fascinated to read over the weekend that the Republicans in the United States proposed a carbon tax over the weekend.
Yes.
The Republicans proposed this. Clearly, it's not a Chinese hoax. Some question on that side? Yes.
Thank you for your presentation. Solar energy can be a good option maybe for many countries, like Middle East countries, because of solar panels, or maybe for Germany,
yeah,
because they do not have natural gas sources. I mean, how about Canada? I mean,
yeah.
Here, as far as I know, I mean, the solar irradiation is around 800.
Yes.
Watts,
yes.
Per,
yeah. Mm-hmm.
Square meter.
Yeah.
So, can be a good option. I yeah. mean, lots yeah. of investments.
Yeah. Okay. So the question is solar a good option for Canada, given that the amount of solar radiation here is low, and second, we have natural gas resources? If you compare the solar radiation map for Germany and Canada, you'll find a very fascinating fact. Every part of Germany receives less solar radiation than almost any part of Canada. We get actually more sun than Germany, okay? It's crazy. Germany has almost the poorest solar radiation in the world. So they went ahead with solar anyway. So that's number one. So Canada actually has more sun. In fact, one of the best places in the world for solar energy is southern Alberta, because they have clear and cold days. And what you need for solar energy is cold days, because the hotter it gets, the less efficient the system is. So southern Alberta can be a powerhouse for solar energy if they put solar panels there. Okay, that's point number one. Number two, you talked about, yes, we have natural gas resources that are cheaper. Germany doesn't have it. They have to buy it from Russia. So that's why they don't want. They want to be energy independent. Energy is a complex topic, as Jatin pointed out. It is very complex. There's political and other considerations that come in. Energy security comes in. But the bottom line is this. If it's going to cost you, let's say, $1,000 to put solar panels on your roof and become independent of the grid by day and by grid by night, why wouldn't you do it, right? And that's where the price point is heading to. If a 3-kilowatt system or a 10-kilowatt system costs you $1,000, $2,000, whatever, you're just going to do it because you can just go to the Home Depot, put it up there, and you're done, right? So the power of individuals is magnified when the prices go down, right? You don't need the mainframe coal plant anymore. You don't need the mainframe natural gas plant anymore because you have the PC solar panel that you can go and buy and install it. The way the PCs overthrew mainframes is being recapitulated in this environment.
And, there are two other points about the solar PV system cost. Usually solar PV system cost includes the inverter converter cost and PV cells.
Yes.
And what actually you mentioned, I mean, it becomes around $2,000 per kilowatt.
Yes, yes. Yeah, so the point she's making is that the cost of solar system has three components to it. The solar panel itself, then there's the associated electronics, the inverter system, and then the support structure, right? While the cost of solar at today is 70 cents a watt or so in Canada, the installed cost is more like $2.35 a watt in Canada today because of the other, what are called, balance of material costs. Both of these balance of material costs are being addressed today by manufacturers. Inverters is electronics. You can buy very cheap inverters today, but not in Canada, okay? You can buy inverters. I mean, Canada's inverter costs about $600. You can buy inverters, same specs, everything, for $50 in India, right? Same electronics, just it's cheaper because there's not a market here, right? That's number one. The cost of setting up a panel, you have to put in, if you go to top of Environment 3 building, you'll see a solar panel system there, right? It's got, I think, 10 kilowatt or 14 kilowatt system. And if you see the support structure, it's girders this thick, you know, like steel girders. Each of them weighs maybe 200-300 kilograms. And it's built to take tornado force winds or something like that. It's crazy. It's extremely overbuilt. We put up 5 panels on top of the energy building over here behind M3. And all that is plastic trays. You fill it with sand and you put the panels on top. It's just as effective and costs like 1/100. Why didn't they do it for Environment 3? Because they weren't available. Nobody thought about it and said, oh, all you need is essentially a big plastic can, fill it with sand, and it won't blow away. They put in with these incredibly over-engineered systems. So people are thinking cleverly about the balance of materials, and I think that's going to come down as well. So, yeah, Maybe I should move on to somebody else so that they can, but I'll be happy to take questions afterwards.
You know what, I assure you, Keshav will be available in the fishbowl to answer your questions, so we can take one more question and then go ahead with the final remarks.
Is there any promised research about increasing efficiency of solar modules for the future to decrease the blaze?
Okay, so the question is there any research on increasing the efficiency of solar modules? So the maximum efficiency of solar modules was computed in 1957 or something like that. Actually, we're the same person who invented the transistor, Shockley. It's called the Shockley limit. It's about 27% approximately at a particular temperature, 25 degrees centigrade. People are looking at different technologies, what are called dye-sensitized solar panels, which allow you to extract energy not just from one band of the energy spectrum, but from other bands as well, infrared, heat as well. And that can pretty much double the limit goes to about 45%. And you can also do one more thing, which is you can get hot water from under the panels, but they get heated up. So you can get sort of thermal energy as well. So by combining the heating of water plus dye-sensitized panels, plus using reflectors, you know, to increase it, you can increase the energy quite a bit. But the typical panel you buy in the market today is between 17% and 22%, and that has been relatively constant for the last many years.
So ladies and gentlemen, I would like to invite Dr. Jatin Atwani on stage for one more time to do the final remarks.
Thank you very much for, of course, your questions, and we have created an opportunity for you to continue these discussions over a reception next door. But I hope that Professor Keshav has really highlighted for you in very clear terms, we are around very disruptive technological interruption coming up that will change the nature of both the energy system that you've known over the last three decades. And I think it's going to get better, both from an environmental standpoint as well as a cost-effective standpoint. And some of the work we're doing here at Waterloo, somebody just asked a question, how about improving the solar efficiencies beyond the PV cells that Keshav talked about? Well, we have Professor Siva's lab looking into next generation solar cells, and there's much to come. The integration of ICT into subsequent energy systems has the kind of promise that he's just barely touched upon. The idea that we are in a world which is actually urbanizing. The world is moving to urban environments, so the issue of density and footprints in terms of what these variable energy systems can actually do, that all can be managed if ICT begins to play an important role. So all very interesting. I'm thoroughly excited, first of course, to be here and be part of this major experiment in global energy transition that we are part of, collectively, number of 100 professors here at Waterloo working on this. And again, thank you very much for your attention, your question, and we should take an opportunity to thank Professor Keshav here.